morning, everybody. Great to be with you this morning. Thank you for tuning into this cyber gathering, this time that we get to spend together and hopefully encourage one another through the word and be reminded that though we are not able to gather, we still are church and get this time to spend together, even though we're in our own homes. So it's good to be with you. Why don't we ask God's blessing on our time together this morning. Father, I want to thank you for each and every one that will be tuning in on this today. Father, would you just help us to gain a perspective that will help us to thrive. We want to give you thanks and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. So I can remember when we were putting up our building and being amazed at just how much time and material went into the foundations. We were drilling huge piling holes and filling them with rebar and bucket loads of concrete, and then huge foundation trenches that were up to the shoulder, and they had reinforcing bars and more concrete that went in there. It seemed like a whole chunk of our budget was being burned up just before we got to ground level. And people who are in the know will tell you that this is the way it has to be. This is what you've got to have. This is what you've got to do if you want to build a building that's going to be strong and it's going to last. In fact, those who are in the know will tell you that that's where all the interesting stuff goes on. It is the foundation that matters. In fact, the thing that's most impressive about most spectacular buildings is the foundations. And most people won't even give them a thought. Most people will look at a building and not even think about what lies beneath. But engineers and History Channel geeks, for them, the story that they really want is the one of the hidden engineering beneath the foundations. That's how you keep the thing standing. Now, this kind of thing is true in people too. We are drawn to those who stand out, to those who thrive in their field, be it sports or business or the arts or adventure. And we want to know the backstory. We want to read the biography because we know that they did not get to where they are alone. We know that they have a platform, they have a foundation upon which they stand, and we want to know what it is. I love the scenes in movies where you have the army down in the valley and they're amassed, and then up on the ridge comes this one guy on a horse, and he's shouting the odds and defying the army, and he's threatening them and he's carrying on. And you look at this guy and you think, how on earth do you do that? Are you a fool? Where do you get the courage to stand there alone on your horse and face this massive army? And then the camera pans up, and as it comes up over the ridge, you just see behind him this mass of men, this massive army, and you go, ah, that's why he can be so brave. You got all these people behind him. Or there's some guy who stands alone in the street facing down the gang of bandits who have held the town ransom for all this time, and he's totally outgunned. How on earth does he find the courage to stand there, staring them down, challenging them, taking them on? And then the shutters of the windows fly open, and all the old townsfolk appear at the windows, toothless grins, shotgun in hand, and then you see the guy up on the roof, and you don't know how he got there, but it doesn't matter because there's a whole lot of guys appear up on the roof, and then there's the obligatory guy up in the bell tower, and he's got to be smoking a cigar, but he's up there, and then at the end of the street, the doors of the old church swing open, and there you can see the old Civil War cannon, the one thing that they had in the arsenal that they needed. And then you know why this guy had the courage. This is where he got his power from. He wasn't there alone. He had these people behind him. He was standing shoulder to shoulder with them. He didn't stand in his own strength. He stands in the strength of his ragamuffin army. So, last week, I challenged you to think about our calling to thrive. We who call ourselves followers of Jesus Christ are not just called to survive, but we are called to thrive. When faced with the trials and uncertainty that we are guaranteed in life, we do not lose heart and we are not overcome. We do not flounder. We thrive. Allow me to remind you what this looks like, what it means to thrive. We get the idea from the things the Apostle Paul prayed for fellow believers, people just like you and I. Thriving means being people who know how to love others in a world that does not. Being people who have hope when all around us others are desperate. People who have a special kind of wisdom, a wisdom that comes from God. People who are able to live a life worthy of the Lord. People who somehow manage to live in a way that is pleasing to God in every way. Being people who do good works. People who are constantly growing in our knowledge of God. People who seem to get stronger and stronger as they get older. And not just bully power, because we know that that eventually fades. But being people who, even when the body seems to get frail, they just seem to get stronger and stronger in themselves. People who have developed great endurance and patience. And people who somehow always manage to exude some kind of deep joy and a reason to give thanks. So that's what it means to thrive. That is what we are called for. And let's face it, it is a tall order. It is quite something. So how are we, ordinary people, with our own fears, our own insecurities, our own struggles, our own limitations, ever going to be anything like this? How are we going to thrive? What is the foundation upon which we can stand? Who's behind us? Who's for us? Where does our thrivability come from? Well, we're not left to guess. The Apostle Paul is about to tell us. He goes on in our chapter, in Colossians, chapter 1 of Colossians, from verse 15, and he speaks of Jesus. This is who is for us. This is who gives us what we need to thrive. He is that solid rock upon which we build our lives, and the behind-the-scenes force that gives us thrivability. Here, take a look. Paul tells us what it is about him and what it is that he has done that makes it possible for him to change our lives and give us the ability to be people who can thrive. Firstly, he points us to who he is. In Colossians chapter 1, verse 15, we read this. About Jesus, he says, he is the image of the invisible God. Okay, we need to stop right away, and we must not miss this. Jesus, this man, is the image of the invisible God. What does this mean? What it means is that he is the physical manifestation of God. Sometimes we hear people say, well, if God is real, why doesn't he just show himself to us? Well, he did. He, the invisible God, came to earth in the body of Jesus. Jesus is the invisible, Jesus is the visible incarnation of the invisible God. It says he is the firstborn over all creation. And what does that mean? Well, we know it can't mean that he is the first person ever born. He wasn't. And we'll see another reason why it can't mean that in just a while. So here's what it does mean. It means that he has priority and superiority. It's a term that would be easier for a family living in the East 2,000 years ago to understand than it is for one of our families or for us to understand. We have a hint of it left in our cultures, but it's that place of privilege, of superiority, of authority given to the firstborn son of a family. In our family, that would be my oldest brother, Peter. And though there's nothing written and there's nothing really even said, there's no doubt that when big stuff happens in the family, we defer to him. What he says holds a lot more weight than what we say. He's the big brother. He has more weight. And I mean that in the nicest way. So out of all the people born, Jesus has first place. He has supreme authority. And here's why this can be said of him. Our passage goes on and it says, "For by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities." You see, this Jesus, he is the creator, and he is the creator of everything. You know those famous 10 words at the beginning of the Bible? In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Most people know these words. Even God haters and skeptics know these words. Anyone who has ever been left alone with the Bible probably knows these words. You know, when no one's looking, let's peel this thing open and see what all the fuss is about. And they get to page one, and the very first words they read is, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth." And for some, that's as far as they go. They think this must be nonsense, and they throw it back on the shelf and pick up their worn copy of Carl Sagan's Cosmos. But some with open minds will read those words and stop and think. And they will realize two hugely important things. One is that this makes so much sense. It answers the big questions. The questions, where did all of this come from? Where did I come from? And that not only does God exist, but he has existed before there was anything else that existed. In the beginning, that is the beginning of anything that has a beginning, God already was. He is the prime mover that we've been looking for. And for those who read on in Genesis, soon find out how he created the heavens and the earth, and they read, "And God said." And God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And if you read on, seven times you will read, "And God said," and it was so. You discover that God spoke into being all that has been made. And those words, "Let there be light," "Let there be," those are the words of Jesus. That was Jesus. He was there before the beginning, and he was doing the creating. And look at what it says, "For by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, invisible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authority." And that covers it. That covers it all. And I know it's hard for us to grasp. But when you go out into the night sky and you look up into the universe in awe, it's awesome, not only because it's beautiful, but because in that moment, deep down, you know that it had to have come from somewhere. You know that it does not end. And that though it is beyond our comprehension, it's still there. And you know that in your heart of hearts, that the argument that this was the result of a big bang was simply chance over time simply does not cut it. And your soul longs to worship the one who spoke it into being. And our passage goes on. All things were created by him and for him. He is before all things, and all things, and in him all things hold together. By him and for him, and everything held together by him. Does that not give you an incredible sense of comfort? The one who created all things and sustains all things has a purpose for them. The universe and everything in it are not there by accident. It will not collapse. It will not crumble by accident. All that is made by him and for him. He has a use for it. And by the way, that includes you. You were created by him and for him. And he has a purpose for you too. And the sooner you accept this, the sooner you can begin to thrive. The sooner you get this, the sooner you can begin to live a life worthy of him who created you. You can know your purpose for living, that it is to please him in every way. Then as our passage goes on, we see the personal connection between this Creator God and us become clear. Verse 18, Paul says, and he, speaking still of Christ, and he is the head of the body of the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. There is this personal relationship described here as the church, that body of people called out into a family of which Jesus is the head. And don't miss this, there's that word again, the firstborn. This time, the firstborn from among the dead. Sounds ominous, doesn't it? But the simple version of this is this. He is the head of those who will be resurrected to life. That's one way of looking at the church. It is that body of people who have the promise of eternal life through resurrection. Jesus being the senior brother, the one who rose to life and paved the way for we who will follow. He gives the promise of that same resurrection life to all who are united with him through faith. The firstborn from among the dead. So our passage transitions from who Jesus is to what he has done. In verse 19. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. So this is the mission of Jesus. This is what he has done. He took on a human body so that he could die a human death. Never read the words blood shed on a cross lightly. Sometimes I hear people use these words without thinking much about what they're saying. But this was the worst of human deaths invented. And why did he do this? Why did he come to earth, take on a human body so that he could die a human death? And the answer is right here, and it is this: to reconcile us to him, to make peace between us. Now stop for a minute and think about the enormity of this statement. This statement assumes that there was a problem between us and God, that we needed reconciling, that we needed peace to be made. And that someone, and this is what's incredible about that, this someone had to take the first step. Someone would have to take the initiative to make peace possible. Someone would have to extend the hand of reconciliation. And this is what God did by coming in the flesh. It was the greatest act of love the world has ever seen and ever will see. And as if just in case the reader of this passage didn't get that from what we've just read, he spells it out and makes it clear in what is to come. Verse 21, he says, once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior. So we were right to assume that there was a problem and it was perhaps more serious than we thought. Hearing it put in these words hits hard. Alienated from God. Enemies, evil behavior. That was the state of our relationship with God, and we were not the good guys. But here's the thing. Knowing this might make us feel uncomfortable, But it should make us forever grateful, because the more we are aware of how bad things were, the more we will appreciate the extent of God's love for us. The Apostle John put it this way. He said, "This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins." So our passage goes on and it says, verse 22, "But now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation, if you continue in your faith, established and firm, not moved from the hope held out in the gospel." This is the benchmark of love. This is how we even know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us. Now, what more could we want or need than the God who created all things, who holds all things together, who has loved us so much that he took on flesh, gave up his life as payment for our sins so that we could become his brother in the forever family of God with the promise of eternal life. What more could we want? What more could we need? This is the foundation upon which we stand. This is the reason we can be expected to thrive. This is the reason we can love in a world that does not. This is the reason we can have hope when all around us people are giving up. This is the reason we can overcome fear. This is the reason that we can persevere with great patience. It is because of who Jesus is and what he has done for us that we can find the reason to joyfully give thanks every day. Now, I don't know how God might use these words to encourage you this morning, but let me encourage you with this. Every day when you wake up, take in a few deep breaths and say to yourself, "I can breathe. I'm alive. This is a good day. This is a good day, and I want to live it in a way worthy of God who has given me this breath. This is a good day, and I want to please him today in every way." And then pray something like this: "God, will you help me through this day to feel your presence, to know that you have gone before me, that you are behind me in all I do, and that the solid rock upon which I am standing is none other than the resurrected Jesus Christ who loves me and calls me to thrive wherever I am." Why don't we pray together? Father, we need to hear this in a time like this, because so many of the foundations around us have been deeply shaken. People around us are afraid and starting to look for something solid to hold on to. Father, I pray that for us we would become acutely aware of the character of Jesus Christ, of what he has done, and the fact that we are united with him through faith, that he is the one who goes before us, he's the one who stands behind us, and it's he who we stand upon. He is the resurrected Christ, and in him we can have hope. Because of him we can thrive. Would you help us to do that today? We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.